Let me perhaps list three main challenges I see for the right to food in the current months, where I believe more research is needed and where more efforts could be put by university researchers. First, we need to improve our understanding of the role of the right to food in the negotiation of trade and investment agreements. In March this year, I presented to the Human Rights Council a set of guiding principles on the human rights impact assessments of trade and investment agreements. The idea was to encourage governments to examine the potential impacts on the enjoyment of human rights, including, although not limited to the right to food, of the trade and investment agreements they negotiate with other governments. As we've seen in the past few years, a significant rise of regional and bilateral trade and investment agreements to support the free movement of goods and capital. And this may have very important implications for the ability of countries to develop food security policies at home, to support their local producers, and to protect their populations from the volatility of food prices. And so I presented these guiding principles. I believe that it would be extremely interesting to provide more tools to policymakers so that they know what they should look at, which methodologies they should use to assess the impacts on the right to food of these agreements in the areas of trade and investment, and to basically make it much easier for them to prepare such human rights impact assessments. This I would like to link with the adoption in November 2011 of the Maastricht Principles on the extraterritorial obligations of states in the area of economic, social and cultural rights. This is a set of principles adopted by independent experts and organizations who in Maastricht in November last year agreed on a set of principles that restate international human rights law with respect to the extraterritorial dimensions of human rights norms that are imposed on states under the UN Charter and international human rights treaties. And it is, I believe, a very important development in human rights law that countries now not only are expected to protect human rights for the benefit of their own population, but also in the activities of transnational corporations abroad over which they can exercise influence, in the way they vote in international organizations, or in adopting measures that can have impacts on populations located outside their national territories. A second area in which more research is needed is to understand the links between food sovereignty and the right to food. Food sovereignty is invoked increasingly in international discussions. It is referred explicitly in the constitutions of Venezuela and Bolivia, for example, and it is a paradigm that is increasingly competing with the classic food security paradigm of the past. Food sovereignty is a way to acknowledge the importance of local communities being able to control their food systems. It is a way to acknowledge the importance of reducing dependency on food imports and to rely as far as possible on local production as a means to build resilience against external shocks. And it is a means of acknowledging the importance of relying on agroecological modes of production that reduce dependency on external inputs and thus reduce the dependency of food production on the volatile prices of fossil energies in particular. So food sovereignty, to me, presents a number of important advantages that seem to me to indicate that there is an alliance to be found between food sovereignty advocates and those defending the right to food. These are different concepts. Food sovereignty is not a legal concept, but it nevertheless could be shaping policies in a direction that is conducive to the full realization of right to food. But this is certainly a second theme on which more research is needed in order to provide the instruments they need to policymakers. Third and finally, we are now witnessing, as you know, a very important phenomenon, that is the increased pressure on farmland and the development of large-scale investments in farmland, and Latin America is one of the targets of this phenomenon, although the most important development in this respect is located on the African continent. Ultimately, the question that is raised by this development of large-scale investments in farmland, and that by this speculation over farmland, is what kind of agriculture do we want? Do we want one that is based on large-scale, heavily mechanized plantations that rely on monocropping schemes and are heavily mechanized, creating little rural employment? Or do we want instead to focus on small-scale farming, family farming, mostly in the hands of the where production is mostly in the hands of the landowners themselves and the local communities concerned, to feed the local markets? That is a choice that is a very difficult one to make. It is the key choice that we are facing today, and it is based on the respective merits of large-scale, heavily mechanized, high-tech farming and small-scale family farming that we must adopt a position on how to regulate large-scale investments in farmland. These issues are difficult to address by lawyers alone, and I think that these issues show that the right to food can only make progress by interdisciplinary research in which, on the one hand, agronomists and development economists can provide lawyers with a better understanding of the impacts of policies in the areas of rural development, agricultural investment, different types of agricultural production, and in which, on the other hand, human rights lawyers can help others understand the benefits of participatory policies, of including victims of the right to food in shaping solutions that can remove the obstacles they face in having access to food, and in understanding how monitoring of progress is absolutely key for the success of strategies that seek to reduce food insecurity and malnutrition. So I believe there is a mutual fertilization, if you wish, between human rights law as a discipline and a legal approach to the right to food, and what agronomists, development economists can contribute, nutritionists also in other respects, and it is only by this joint endeavor that we can make progress in making the right to food ever more relevant in the shaping of public policies.